time for the next speaker, and that's Dr. Alex Tournier.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Brika. Hello again, everybody. Awake. Good. Before I start, I wanted to mention the HR conferences. So you heard yesterday about the conference we had in Barcelona. It was great. We had 180 people, 40 presentations from groups from around the world. It's really a great event. The feedback has been amazing. So I encourage you to go and have a look at our website about the conference. So this is the conference website, HR Barcelona 2013. Soon you'll be able to download and look at the presentations that were made in Barcelona by all these world experts in homeopathy research. So they'll be you'll be able to catch up. Because everything was filmed in HD, like here, I guess. So, and also we are going to have another conference in 2 years, in probably the same May, June 2015. And so look out for that. And if you're interested, just sign up for our newsletters and you'll get all the information. So, yesterday I left you very confused. Wait, where was this slide? Very confused about where we'd be going. And I was just really trying to set the scene for today. So we're still looking. We have a number of ingredients as to what homeopathy, the homeopathy effects are. And we're kind of now trying to say, okay, well, how could I ever explain all this weird stuff? So we looked at nanoparticles, and to me, that there's some aspects that I just can't see how nanoparticles are going to help us explain something like the crosstalk effect or the involvement of electromagnetic radiation. So kind of going back to the drawing board and saying, okay, maybe nanoparticles are probably involved in some way, but maybe there's something about the water structures that we need to look at deeper. So let's look at water again. So water is simple. Well, that's the idea, that really. We all think it's simple. We're 80% water, but really it's actually quite one of the most complicated substances known. I mean, it has 18 phases. You know, water, ice, and vapor, but actually there's another 12 phases of ice that, you know, and other types of water that are out there. There's something called supercritical water, which is below a freezing point, water can remain liquid. But if you cool it super quickly, it will remain liquid below freezing point, and then if you touch it, it instantaneously freezes. It has really weird things it can do. So, you know, it's not finished by any means, the research into water. And just to show you some of the more recent stuff that's been done by researchers in California, Dr. Lowe, and this is published in a very respectable physics journal, actually one of the best physics journal, Physics Letters A. And what they've been doing is using what's called an atomic force microscopy, which is basically a little microscope that probes surfaces, and they're able to see structures in water. This is ultra-pure water with just a bit of salt, basically, sodium chloride. And they see these streaks, so they call them, they think it has to do with some kind of a helix. And here it's more like kind of cloudy. But you can see these small elements, like the little dots. And it seems, well, that's what they see. And it could be that they're sort of looking at water structures that are combining it through these small structures. So that's experiment. And also here they did another one with electron microscopy. So there you're using electrons instead of photons to look at things, and they see these kind of fiber-like things. And also you can see these microstructures within it. And you'll see in a minute why I'm pointing those out. So, what I want to tell you about is the quantum coherence domains. The idea of quantum coherence domains is an expansion of quantum electrodynamics, which was developed by Richard Feynman, and for which he, for a big part of that was for his Nobel Prize, he got his Nobel Prize for. And basically, quantum electrodynamics describes the interaction of, say, an electron with light. So a lot of this physics is used for all, all that's with electronics and stuff. So that's what it's used for. Now, what Preparata did, so this is an Italian theoretician, he expanded this theory and looked at what would happen if you have not point particles but dipoles, and so water molecule actually form an electric dipole. They have a negative and a positive side, so they form this dipole. And he looked at what happened if you put dipoles into an electromagnetic field. So it's an expansion of this, now looking at dipoles in an electromagnetic field. And what he saw, what he predicted, is that there would be ensemble sets of dipoles could form a quantum state, to congeal, so to speak, into a quantum state. So, and to show you, give you a picture of what this could mean, we know that at low temperatures, so very low temperatures, close to zero, you get weird effects, that's the superfluids and superconductivity. These effects, superfluids, are due to whole ensembles of atoms in the material forming a quantum domain, forming a quantum state, where then the whole set of atoms behaves differently. It basically behaves like one object, quantum object. So it has very weird properties at that point. So we know these things exist at low temperatures. And basically, what we're saying is that as you raise the temperature, we know that these domains, so the amount of matter that's able to congeal in a quantum state breaks apart. So it breaks into different pieces. And then the idea here is that at room temperature, you would still have microscopic quantum domains, so remnants of, say, a superfluid, but at room temperature, and you have these small quantum domains. So please raise your hands if you have questions, because there's no point in... Yeah, it's okay. Like yesterday, just... So, going on. So the idea here is that... So to describe it, the prediction is that you would have a quantum coherence domain. So think of a set of water molecules that's about the size of a protein, and they would form a quantum structure that would be kind of quasi-stable. Okay, and that these structures would form about 25% of the volume of normal water. Okay, now the idea is these quantum structures, because of the fact, because it dipoles basically, they're able to register information, specifically register information of, say, this is a protein, but it could be anything that's put into water. Then these quantum domains could register this information, this electromagnetic information coming out of the material. You then, the thing with quantum materials is that they have no inherent dissipation. That is, they don't wear out. that is, once you've put something in this and you don't touch it, it can go on forever. You know, because quantum, because of the quantum properties, it doesn't radiate. That's what we call, and radiation would be loss, so it would go away. So this, that one of the quantum properties is that it doesn't do that by itself. You have to excite it, and then you would get a signal out. So this is the type of thing that Montagnier and Benveniste also have been looking at. If you remember yesterday, they looked at things like that. If you don't excite the sample, then you don't see any spectra at all. So you can play around with experiments like this, and they showed, so if you use a mu metal box to shield all excitation, then you don't see anything out. They have another property that's predicted, is that if they have similar information, if they encode similar information, they would tend to attract each other. Whereas, you know, if they have dissimilar information, then they kind of keep apart. So this has a, you know, consequence is that quantum domains with the same information tend to cluster. Now, these are all the ingredients. Now let's see what happens and how we could explain homeopathy. So if you imagine a simple dilution, so you've got a substance and, you know, it's just got its quantum domains around it because it's in a solution. And you just put it into water, but you don't do anything specific with it. You just dilute it, and then eventually, you know, it just goes away. So that's what, you know, that's basically the problem we've always had with homeopathy. If you dilute stuff, it's going to go away. So, but if you add a succussion now you've got your stuff with the succussion, and what happens with the succussion is that it kind of enables the clusters of these quantum domains to kind of break up, because you're giving it a vigorous shake and allow the quantum domains to kind of break apart and spread around the sample. So now your sample looks a lot more with information. So if you now take some of that and put it in the next dilution, shake it around, you're spreading your information through the succussion process. And therefore, at the end of the process, you don't have any more of the original substance, but you have your informed quantum domains. And now, if you think about how you would give that to a patient, then take some of these domains, give them to a patient, and we know in many experiments, and some of the stuff I did for my PhD, showing that frequencies can influence the rate of enzymes. So you can play with accelerating or decelerating the rate of certain enzymes just by shining different frequencies on them. So here I'm just saying, you know, the hypothesis is that these quantum domains would affect the rate of certain enzymes, or at least communicate with proteins in our body through this electromagnetic information. So that's kind of the idea. And then I just want to show you how it could explain, say, the crosstalk effect. So here, the idea is that you've got a sample with coherent information. The quantum domains have got coherent information there. So they tend to cluster together, which kind of locks in the information. Here, you don't have all this information. And then as time goes on, the information passes across, because basically this guy is just picking up what is consistently being fed from here. So, and people have played around putting a mu metal shielding, so mu metal shields electromagnetic radiation, and if you do that, then you don't get any transfer of the information. Now, that's just so in my opinion, the quantum domains explain quite a lot of things. They explain the crosstalk, they can explain the electromagnetic. They would be heat sensitive, because as you would boil them, the quantum domains would break apart. And also if you freeze it, when you freeze something, you force the water molecules into specific crystalline phases, it would break the information that was in the quantum domains. Yeah, and it doesn't need anything specific to do, you know, like silica or lactose. There's different theories about maybe we require silica, lactose. This would not require it at all. So really, here I'm just saying, we don't know about its bioactivity yet. We don't know, we're not able to test all this. There's a lot of work to be done. But it seems promising. And, oh yeah, I just added this slide because I thought it was funny, but it has the potential, you know, olfaction. We all, it's like one of the trick questions is how do you explain olfaction? Because these domains are actually very small, they're kind of like mini snowflakes. They, in principle, could easily evaporate. They could easily come off the surface of the liquid. And so it would be another way to take them in our body would be just to breathe them in. Anyway, that kind of works. And then coming back to the question of a lady yesterday, yes, you know, placebos. It has, you know, a lot of consequences in terms of placebos. You have to be careful how you treat your placebo, because if you leave your placebo on top of your verum, so say, then your placebo is not going to be a placebo anymore. Does that make sense? No? and that's a possible source of why a lot of trials have failed in the past, especially we've seen trials on cattle and farming where both the verum group and the placebo group got better. And we suspect that one of the reasons for that is that when they were storing the placebos and the verum, they were storing them in, you know, just piling them up. And so the placebo was not a true placebo anymore. And so we've seen other, like in the provings also, they've seen that sometimes the placebo group tends to do the same thing as the verum group. This could be due to these type of effects. So for me, my future work, yeah, I'm, as of last week, going full-time researching homeopathy. So that's what I intend to do. Looking into quantum domains and trying to get some experiments going. And that's it for me, really. That's thank you. I'm a bit faster.
Thank you very much. We have questions.
I'm a bit fast.
Thank you very much, Alex. Very interesting as usual. I just thought you were a little dismissive about nanoparticles, because actually there's three different kinds of nanoparticles, and you only talked about one of them. So the one is traces of the original substance.
Yeah.
And that is a bit problematic how they come to be there in these very high dilutions. The Belleri group from Mumbai suggests it's because they take it from the very surface of the very top surface of the liquid, and there you have a surface tension phenomenon. So that's why it happens. But it is difficult to explain. And there are classical experiments showing that actually the using traces, which show actually the concentration goes down in a linear fashion, yeah, exactly as predicted, done by Jean Boiron a very long time ago. But there are other nanoparticles, which certainly exist, which are most gas bubbles and silica. And John Ives has shown that, and indeed Lionel showed some years ago very elegantly that some results claimed by a guy called Kant were simply due to the fact he used cheap glassware and had a lot of silica. Mm-hmm. So the silica part of those gas particles. In terms of domain, we now have three different people saying that coherent domains exist within water. Most of them seem to think it's around gas. So that's the late, great Louis Ray. De Mangeat, Montagnier, and now Vittorio Elia. All of them are predicting saying they've observed indirectly domains, although the estimates vary from about 4 microns to 100 microns, the diameter.
Yeah. I mean, you're quite right. I'm sorry if I sound very dismissive of the nanoparticles. I think the the nanoparticles, the idea that the original substance would stay there beyond, say, 30C, doesn't quite convince me. I mean, it's not really possible. However, that the presence of glass nanoparticles or gases, nanobubbles, yes, most probably they have something to do. And even going further, if we look at the research of De Mangeard using nuclear magnetic resonance, he showed basically that if you don't use pure water, but use water that has already some ions in it, so ionic solution, so they would be able to register the information better. That is, the idea here might be that in order to form these structures, whatever the water structures are, whether they're quantum or something else, we might need actually impurities to crystallize this information. That is, pure water doesn't seem to be very good at capturing the information. It needs impurities, whether it's ions, whether it's something from the glass, whether it's gases, that kind of form nucleating points for the water structures. So I do think there's some form of nanostructures, nanoparticles of some type, but probably not, in my opinion, emanating from the original substance. We still are faced with a problem where the information from the original substance needs to be registered in some way, in some kind of water-based structures around some impurities. So that's kind of the thinking.
My name is Pasi. You talked about that, yes, placebos get kind of contamination from verums, but what about verum versus verum?
Well, the idea here is that, and the experiments seem to, well, the experience, I mean, everyday experience seem to indicate that, at least within this theory, the quantum domains, because they cluster together, they kind of self-reinforce each other. And that kind of would lock down the information, so thus avoiding contamination from sample to sample. You know, if it's, but placebo, not having any coherent information itself, kind of pick up anything that's around. That's the idea.
Well, you've been talking about the information in the water, forming clusters and breaking up clusters. But when we are using homeopathic remedies, the medium is sugar, right? Mm. So it's mixed with a lot of alcohol and then poured on the pills. So what happens with the clusters?
So that's a very good question. And I do have a form of answer. All this is tentative, yeah? So this is all speculative at this point. But the people I showed you at the beginning with the atomic force microscopy experiments, they went further as well. They actually evaporated the water, normal water, and managed to get all the crystals, all the coherence domains, or whatever you want to call them, to get to the bottom. So they have this one picture in that paper, I don't have it on my slide, but where they are able to take a picture of room temperature ice. And they go further and they actually put this into the mass spectrometer to verify that it's actually water. So the idea is that these structures, whatever they are, might be quite stable and might remain stable while on the sugar pills. And that's the idea. But
Alex.
Jack in the Box.
I thought I'd just try and sort of inform people about the possibility that what you're saying and what I'm saying might apparently be seen to be contradictory.
Mm.
In other words, you're looking at it from a molecular phenomenological point of view, and I'm looking at it more from a sort of human phenomenological point of view. Do these two points of view meet, do you think?
Thank you.
My pleasure.
Yeah, that's a good question and one we talked about, so it's great. I do think that at some point, I mean, this explanation with the quantum domains on a very local level, on a very material level of what's happening will meet with bigger explanations about what happens with the, you know, the patient practitioner interaction. I mean, anybody who's practiced homeopathy knows that sometimes there seems to be something happening in the interaction itself. And this is these type of observations would go more in line with, you know, patient, you know, really looking at the patient practitioner interactions, where Lionel's thinking would be more relevant than the more just the pill idea. So, yeah, in the future, there's something
future
there.
We all come together. Yeah, jolly good.
More questions?
Okay.
Alex, in Barcelona, Dr. Iris Bell was with us through a webinar, and she said something about, you know, when potentizing, when actually shaking the mixture, that it was different using a glass bottle or using plastic. Mm. Could you explain that? She said something that the glass in itself had some properties.
Yes.
Great. Thank you.
Yeah.
Right.
But presumably it's because when you succuss, things come off the glass. I mean, particles come off the glass. Yeah.
How stable were these quantum domains you're talking about? How long do their effects persist?
In the experiments done by the...
Yeah.
I don't think they did any... They didn't give any time indication on the on those set of experiments. Peter can probably help me out with the experiments that showed the lifetimes of remedies. But I don't think it is. Indications are that it's like a year. It can be stable for a year, but I don't know any...
Well, of course, the traditional, if you read animals...
Sorry, I will come with the microphone.
The tradition is that they are very, very have very long lifetimes, and Hahnemann says this himself. And indeed, in the UK, we have one of Hahnemann's original medicine chests. Unfortunately, we don't have a way to test whether they're still active. But again, I will show this afternoon. Elia, Vittorio Elia from Naples, says that has looked at them over the course of 3 years and says the effect is getting stronger. The effect gets greater over a three-year time span. Don't ask me how... Maybe that's just Neapolitan science, but I don't know.
So I just wanted to add to that question is that for me as a physicist, when as soon as you talk about lifespans that are even days, then conventional physics is pretty much incapable of explaining it. That is, we don't, within standard physics, there is no way these structures could keep that type of information for so long. And that's why I favor the kind of quantum approach where we know that in quantum systems, information can be locked pretty much indefinitely because there's no dissipation. So that's why, personally, I think there must be something of that nature just in order to explain the lifetime of these this information.
Yeah, it's okay, I can make myself heard.
Oh, it's all right. I want it on the microphone. You.
On your website, you have a little speech where you talk to people, and you mentioned possible industrial applications of these findings. Would you like to expand on that?
Yeah, that's a great question. The idea here is that, well, there's two aspects of that question. One is a very simple one, which is if it's true that there are such things as quantum domains, and that then if they exist, we know that they can do things like accelerate enzymatic reactions. The Dr. Lowe in California actually stumbled upon all this when he was looking at catalysts for diesel engines. So the group with the AFM, actually that's how they got into homeopathy, is by looking at catalysts for diesel engines. So there might be a lot of implications for a lot of applications, industrial applications, such as catalysts, different types of chemical reactions, and things like that, potentially. Yeah, basically that would be my answer, yeah.
I have another question here.
I'm not a scientist, and I just wondered what the rules of proving something scientifically is. Does it have to be one answer, or does it have to be lots of answers, or does it have to be exclusively one answer, or can there be lots of different...
Well, eventually it will all converge. I mean, what's really good right now is that we have different possible solutions, whereas maybe a few years ago, nobody, you know, it was very hard to find any solution. So it's better to have a few things on the table, and probably all of them are right at the same time. So, I mean, it's quite possible, quite likely that nanoparticles are involved in some way. You know, that's really, you know, it depends how everything comes together. I'm calling them quantum domains, but actually they're kind of a nanoparticle as well. So all this is going to come together in some way.
Yeah, I'm not questioning what you're saying. Don't know what if there is a rule of scientifically proving something. You know, I can't explain.
Well, it's all work in process, and eventually the idea is that we will come to one explanation that will explain everything, and that we will be able to make experiments that will test that particular theory.
There's no one rule, but in my talk, I will talk about a few strategies that you can use. So maybe that will answer some of your questions.
Thank you, Alex. I have a question. So in a homeopathic pharmacy where you have all different dilutions and substances in different potencies, there is no danger of crossover because they are, if I understood you right, they are stable after they are potentized.
Mm.
Right.
That's the idea, because of the they all cluster together.
Right. Any more questions?
Just on this issue of domains, one of the criticisms is if there are domains, well, surely there are domains in all water.
Yes.
And there's this famous statistic that people love to throw out, I don't know whoever calculated it, that in every litre of water, there is one molecule that at one time passed through the bladder of Oliver Cromwell. And if you don't know Oliver Cromwell was the dictator of England. He died in 1660. Whoever calculated that or how, I don't know. But the point is, it's coherence, isn't it? The point is, there may be small organized domains, but there is no coherence throughout the body of water. Is that not the point?
Yeah, I mean, yes. So all water would have these domains. That's one of the predictions. It's just that there wouldn't be the same information in all the domains in the water. So that's why normal water doesn't, we don't have a problem with tap water, it just carries an inhomogeneous set of information, whereas potentized water would carry the same information throughout the sample. I mean, this interesting thinking is like, for example, if you start thinking like that, what happens when you potentize normal water, you know, we do stochastic controls, are we just picking up information and making it, it's just a weird, because we're using stochastic controls right now, but if you stochastic control, you're kind of amplifying whatever was there at the beginning. So it's kind of a weird thing. And also I just want to throw out, just to put it out there, that if you really think about it, these water domains, whatever they are, predate life in some, you know, in some way. So they predate life. So life would have evolved always working with this thing, with quantum domains or whatever it is that homeopathy is working with. So it's not impossible and quite likely that life used that information from the very beginning. That is, life kind of, the more, because also what we see with homeopathy is that it works best with more complex organisms. And the idea here might be that complex organisms learned to use the information carried by the quantum domains as early detection for chemicals or for different things. So they would detect things in the environment and be able to adapt better than other life forms. Does that make sense? So I'm just saying that probably life evolved using all this.
Right. It was the last question. We have to carry on. And the next speaker, thank you very much, Dr. Alex Tournier.